My dad was born in 1919. He was a hero. He lived to be 95. To find yourself in Normandy, in one of the biggest battles like the world's ever seen, transported through Holland, Belgium, Italy, France, Austria, Germany. The friends he made then and the experiences he had then, there's no doubt that had the biggest impact on his life, and he treasured those experiences.
I was 20 in 4 months,
yeah.
February
15th. 1940.
I went February 15th to, yeah, Central. On a Thursday, always on a Thursday, we got kitted out. We started parades on Monday. I was at Central about 15 weeks. I was in recruits for about 9 weeks. And then we moved to infantry air buildings. They were brick buildings. The recruit building were huts. And then France fell, and they were Dunkirk, while we were still at Central. And then they moved us to Scotland, just over the border. Lovely little place. Anyway, we were only there a few weeks. And then they moved us to Iceland. We caught the ship in at Greenock.
I grew up in the middle of a steel-producing area in Carbrook. You know, there were Jessop, Savile, Dunford, Hadfields and all the big steelworks. You just can't imagine what sort of life it was. They really did, like, play football in the streets with pigs' bladders. Just off Attercliffe Common, between Attercliffe Common and the canal, there was a pond near there as well where they used to go one-legged swimming. They could never swim, my dad.
Yeah, well, at Greenock, well, it was E Company, the extra company. They showed who they wanted to make up the number, what they were short. And I tried to be chosen because I stuck my soft chest out, picked me sort of thing. And they didn't. And when they were marching off, the officer and sergeant who were in charge went back into the office. And I was close by. And he said to me, "Do come on, we'll be here again, they'll not know." So I hesitated a second, then I joined them. This line of Andes waiting. So we were first on, and actually we went to these here little cabins, up top of the ship, first deck. We went in alone before a boy said, "Out!"
HMS Andy.
Down A deck, B deck, C deck, below the engine, to where Mary's at bottom, with his hammocks to sleep on, and biscuit, what they call biscuits. And,
yeah,
these big square biscuit things.
Oh, like mattresses?
Like mattresses, yeah. Mm. And they were packed on bottom, you know, and with a little ladder to go up to the next deck, where they were toilets. And also, first that left, they worked to dining room. So it's a climber's ladder. And it was breakfast, dinner, and so on. Then we got his life jackets. Mine were four, they were either like a pillar, at front and back, the head in between. Or you got like four pieces of cork, two at front and two at back. I had that. He had a caravan here one time. We were 3 days on the ship before we moved. Because we were first on, you see. So they put other stuff on, other troops, and what we needed, you see. Because it's all 2,000, apart from crew. I thought it was funny because I went sick. And then we went to the sea, open sea, come out of Rail Clyde into open sea. Well, headed towards Iceland, I was sick. But that was the only time I was sick. I wasn't sick no more.
Everybody's got a story, as we know. people nowadays can't conceive of what they went through. And there were thousands or hundreds of thousands of them was plucked from that background, and all of a sudden, they're in the war.
When we landed, we were out of breath because change of air, like you go to a place, but it knocked you out. You didn't realise it until you were fighting for breath, until you got used to it. It was your light first, because it took me this little calendar, it was your light first, so I'll have that, so we knew. That when we landed, didn't you?
Yeah.
And we were on a canvas there, big marquees, and we were in these bell tents, in this little, like, gully or ravine, whatever you call it.
Yeah.
Among all rocks, there were rocks, you see, and they were eddy from fjord. They're little eddies, you call them, isn't it? But little out inland. Mm. And they're all rocks, where the photo took, the robbers took it, that up left him. And on the canvas. And we did training, you know, and things like that.
He took everything in his stride, and he was so unselfish. It's ridiculous. He several times got promoted to Lance Corporal and didn't like it. He wanted to be one of the lads.
We went to Reykjavik first, to follow them up at Reykjavik, round to Akureyri, then come round right hand side out and down towards Sadie's Fjord to drop them off there to be D Company. Then they were the A Company, and then to Sadie's, Radies Fjord. There were Sadie's, Radies, and also Eski Fjord in between, a little one.
Yeah.
And they said, when we landed at Radies Fjord, the place, that little place was called Budareri, and there was a co-op building there, a big square where they used to do parades and guards. God did to go out to God, and he was there. Yeah, and they sent us straight away to Eskfjord to a place called Vatnes, where there were a lighthouse.
Yeah.
And there was a section of us in a platoon, there was three sections. The section of us, we were about eight of us, were privates, eight privates. And we were still going God, taking a turn and going God. You take your rifle, he did 2 hours.
It was 20. The furthest he'd gone with, he used to be on his old iron bike. He might have ridden 40 miles out of Sheffield on his iron bike with his brother and mates. But to be suddenly transported through Holland, Belgium, Italy, France, Austria, then to find yourself in Normandy in one of the biggest battles like the world's ever seen. He treasured those experiences and they were with him right up to the end.
And then when they said the Germans had landed at Sadie's Fjord.
Oh, you thought Germans had landed, yeah.
Yeah. So, forced march. You know, got it on very quick. We thought it was real. That day, that morning, I put old socks on, what we needed to do, repair it. So, wool.
Darning.
Yeah. And I saw it in long land. Oh, bother. Got caught all the way, didn't I? I had to march. That was about 19, 20 miles. We rested halfway, we had a meal. They were waiting with meal, all in boxes. We call them hay boxes. Like they kept things warm.
Were they metal?
Yeah.
Metal, like metal tins?
Yeah, they were lid to them.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
And they were clipped fastened. And when we got there, off with it, England, and messed it out. Some arc down his stuff, you know. And they stopped after 50 minutes, we'd walked 4 miles. And they stopped for 10 minutes, take your boots off, put them back on, and off again. And then, right when we got to the top, a hill, I was feeling it, you know.
Yeah.
It's one or two saddles as well, you know. But, I kept going and we took the ready with meal. We had his meal and I fell asleep out the office. More exhausted. And then he wiped his up right and everything. Some training again, you know. ready for, but you suppose Germans were to land.
Yeah.
You see.
Yeah.
We started by, you know, pretending fighting at one another, doing this little manoeuvres like in Dad's army. And then we marched, carried on marching, and I felt great. Anyway, because it was downhill then, into, it'd be Sheffield. Yeah, and we were just at the outskirts of Sheffield. In tents again.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, when did you find out that Germans hadn't landed?
And it was out of rope to get there. It was training. It was a training exercise. You come up with this idea, tell them a lot of Germans were landing then. Next day we set up back. And others we had not trucked and lapping. And I had a guest who were with me when we joined up at Central. He come from Cullif. He were older than me.
Yeah.
He got on truck and laughing at me. Come on, don't get. I said, no, I'm gonna walk. And I walked back with my blistered feet, but I'd been seen to.
Yeah.
I wouldn't go sick any time. I wouldn't go sick. And we did Pony Patrol.
Oh, yeah.
They see a stable, they got about four or five ponies. And that first time on us. Well, it was a pony, small horse pony. It used to be 10 miles, 5 days, 5 back. And we were supposed to be looking to see any Germans in London, you see. And then across this university, which got a...
Yeah, I've seen that picture, yeah.
Yeah. I respected pony, and you know, I treated it lovely. Anybody nice to me. Some of them are a bit rough with them, you know. They can be like mules, stubborn. And they treat them rough, but I didn't. And when we got to end the crossroads, we raced about 150 yards from that, to the stables. We had a race. And when you're trotting like that, it's worse. You want them to canter, you see, canter. But when you start trotting, you know, you're shy. I don't know an old woman. I never fell off, but it was okay. Before I went into three quarters, I was Brengel.
Ah, yeah, I wondered what stage that were.
You see, Edel Stadder, they were firing machine Bren gun at these barrels, empty barrels, 55 gallon, floating on Eddie and his field. And the fire meant rifles first, and then were machine gun at these barrels. Bren gun. And our best.
Right. Bren gunner.
Number one. And Jack McCarr from York were number two. Each gun had a Bren carrier.
Yeah.
Up and top.
Yeah.
Not like a small tank, but up and top.
Yeah.
And they were fast, quick turn round, could change, faster than a tank. Then after a while, they're going to make a support company out of Allard for 3 mortar. So I went on one course. A Sheffield sergeant was in charge. And I were on my own, there were no mates. And then when it was over, a couple of weeks it were, they come, and they liked it. So I went back, because it was Sheffield going, now from Sheffield, he said, well, and I, come on, you can join. So I went at 3 mortars. He learnt all about 3 mortars. And then, because I was fastest, putting bombs down, you were number two, you, because you did number one, that were getting sights. There were spirit level, two spirit levels. You were number one to get on target. You had aiming posts, and you had an observer telling you where your bomb was dropping by phone. You see, easy. He says, talk, have a thing around
the microphone at throat.
And down 50, up 50, something like that, you know. You fire either above, beyond, maybe 50 hours or before. Then you get your MPI, which is the mean point of impact.
Mm-hmm.
Right, kind of fire for effect, then you start fire for. That's how I did it. So I did number one, number two, number three, and you say, hey, Duke, let Duke be number two. And it was a lap from, well, a chap that ordered me, from Leeds, he was number three. They were a lap from London for number one. They were good to hear all that. Well, we were actually working to kitchen employers, like waiters, taking food, which were in, it used to be petrol tins, opened up and cleaned. Of course, you got tin bacon, bacon in tins, like tin bean. And there was a big vat, boiling water in, and it took tins in, with all of them.
Yeah.
So it would explode, because you've got to put all puncture.
Yeah.
But then, and same doing tea. The big bag, they were not tea bags then, they were loose tea leaves in the big bag, and the women like that, boiling water. Till they were coloured enough.
Yeah.
Then it was up the next one. That way. And they sit at the table, and there'd be a tin between six on you. Tin of bacon, and they were wrapped in paper, and it was streaky bacon. See, hardly any fat on it. Any lean, it mostly fat. And then it got to one before, and then we got biscuits to eat, not bread, till he got bakery up.
Yeah.
But for biscuit dough, you used to soak the biscuits in a big bath, zinc bath,
yeah,
overnight, to soften them up. And then they made them into a pudding, and it was lovely. Fill your stomach. I grabbed for more, and a book sheet. How was it? Was it again? Played football for D Company.
Oh yeah, well that's against.
Their left winger, a big lad, good, strong, and they see me play. Cause they see me playing. I play football. See me all. And they asked me, "Will you play for us?" And the officer says, "Yes, all right." So I played a winger and won match for them. We winning goal.
What was score?
Bang, he went straight on the crossbar, he took inside the crossbar and bounced it back and told it. And the effect of that, they were electrifying, you see. And they had the bottles of beer from Canada called Dow, D-O-W.
Yeah.
2 shilling a bottle.
2 shilling?
Yeah, and we only got then to get about 3 shilling a day.
Yeah, so you couldn't afford to buy them normally. One, yeah.
You only did one.
One.
Because it was strong.
Yeah.
And the old lads were there, they got a bit, they were a bit rough, these lads. Because I'd have been our hero. Just for that once. When snow came, it was perishing, you know, it went about 30 below.
Yeah.
And we had snowshoes, skis, and we were training to become the mountain division. And we weren't good enough. This 51st, 49th division, this 51st division were Welsh division. They became mountain division.
Probably more used at mountains.
And you could go on a Sunday and go to where skis were, sign for them, get a pair of skis, and you got your own snowshoes. Take and leave them there and go up on skis. And we climb mountains like that. Well, they were hills.
Yeah, yeah.
Walk that way. You know.
Sideways.
And then learn to come down and jump. Mine, this is end. I could hear to end the service in Iceland with a 2 year to mum.
Yeah.
He was in Iceland for 2 years, but then he was in training in this country and in Scotland, and he's in Normandy. They're fighting the Germans. You cannot conceive nowadays that the Nazis being 20 miles away, you know, across the channel, and you're actually threatened. You see the war films, you see the documentaries, and they're vivid, but you cannot understand the reality of being in that situation.
As all advanced towards its village, Crystal, is shrapnel flying all about and noise.
Yeah.
And I published it on my helmet and took up the dint in it. My shrapnel, is it?
Yeah.
It could have been friendly fire.
Well, probably.
Yeah. And they were, they said, jokingly, they said, does it that way, am I? So the motorist moves, and there's a tank come on our right hand side, yeah, and driver, sliding, Doug sliding, says, let this go first, or let that go.
Yeah.
And it went over the vine, and his track come up.
Yeah.
Right hand track come up. And of course, then it was like a pillbox.
Mm.
And we went round it and across this field towards these pooper houses.
Yeah.
Over a slight bedding. And we got shunned by a problem. Well,
yeah.
It could have been mortars, but it was fire.
Yeah.
So, driver, Bill Sladin, whipped.
Were it Slavin?
Bill, S-L-A-D-I-N.
Sladin.
Sladin. And he whipped, carried it round and come back out.
Yeah.
We were sat at back. So we were nearest.
Yeah.
So we all crouched up inside Ben Carrier. And we got safely round back. The first attack of it on Arnhem were failed with parachutes and airborne. The rest of us couldn't get through because they could see every movement. Because all of the flat.
Yeah.
And the roads were high and they could only see us. We couldn't get through them. But eventually that'd be September. But then probably
September 44.
Yeah, 44. Then following year, about January, February time, decided to take it. And Montgomery came out to see us. They said Montgomery's coming. He won't come to see us. But then we thought, oh yeah, because it was Arnhem.
Yeah.
So we were part of the attack on Arnhem. But he saw us that morning, or we saw him, a couple of visitors. In the afternoon, we played football, because we weren't going to go towards Arnhem until midnight.
Yeah, yeah.
And the ground we played on was undulating, and I jarred my ankle, which was swollen. Not a lot, but it was swollen. I could walk, but it walked with a limp. And in his house, this, in Holland, it was central heating, they got radiators. And
yeah.
They got hot and cold water, which was convenient.
That'd be unusual for you, coming from Kerbrook.
So I bathed me with hot water, bathed my ankle, and wrapped leaves around, and carried on. And when it was time to get ready to cross this year, Bailey Bridge, towards Holland, which were actually Oosterbeek. And I climbed on, okay, and I said, don't send them. I didn't want to go away from
them.
I always wanted to be with me, everybody said. And we got billeted in these flat, little flats, what we used. And then we went from there to this nappy. What they used as a nappy.
Yeah.
Near River Danube.
Oh.
When the blue, weren't blue.
No.
As we're coming away from there, it sinks on truck. We come to this cafe. We thought, we'll stop and have a drink. Officer comes in, orders it out.
A Russian officer, yeah.
Of course we were more together than those other Russians.
Yeah.
We're friends, like, weren't we? We just sauntered back to the seat on top. And as we got on turn, I said to some Russians, others, are going pickers to us like that,
yeah.
Like Churchill.
Yeah, yeah.
Of course, we went the other way. Yeah. And did this opposite, we were doing like that. And we all went back, up, round, up to, yeah. Up to the top, where we were.
Yeah.
And that was a week before I left to be debunked. On 28th of April, 1946. These are Germans, SS troops, at Utrecht.
Mm-hmm.
And there were piles of stocks of food outside Utrecht.
Yeah.
But people in Utrecht must have been starving.
Yeah.
Kids had died. All their food get to them. And as we went in, they were either side of the road, already armed.
Who were?
Arrogant looking.
What, SS?
SS looking around at us, like that afternoon. We had them in, you see, a park.
A park.
And disarmed them.
Yeah.
And that we'd have papers sent from home, which was like Empire News, Sunday paper. But these photos are what they'd been at these
concentration camps. Yeah.
Where they'd use where all the bodies were.
Yeah.
Skeletons.
Yeah, so Belsen and places like that. Mm.
I saw them in this SS officer. This is Nick's propaganda. Didn't believe me. So I personally disarmed him.
You disarmed an SS. SS officer.
Yeah. And they kept the personal things.
Yeah.
You know, other than personal.
Yeah. They you got their arms. Yeah.
Yeah. And they were in line.
Yeah.
All in line. And I went first.
Must have been a bit intimidating, that.
Yeah,
it
was.
Yeah.
It was. In the morning, as we were leaving lads in Austria, in this house, well, it was stepped into the room above. We stepped on the floorboard. And Jim Rawson, who had been with me from day one in the army.
How long was that?
6 years, 2 months. Say, as I'm going down the steps, that ladder, don't go down, don't go. I said, Jim, I've got to go. I'm married now, you know. And I've never seen him from that day to this. And he come from Cudder, Barnsley.
He'd come back from the war, had to adjust to Civvy Street. He had to look after, very quickly, had to look after three foster children. He could have walked away from it. He didn't, he wasn't that sort of bloke. So I'm sort of getting a bit emotional now. He became a bit of a hero for me. He was so down to earth. He was then made redundant in his late 40s and after about a year unemployed, he got a job on a tarmac gang and then he spent the rest of his working life, until he was 76, working on a tarmac gang, and loved it. He was always good-humoured. His glass was always half full to full, and rarely half empty. For all he'd been through, the fact that he remained so even, his temperament so cool, and calm. It was terrific.
Does your heart fill with pain? Shall I come back again? Tell me, dear, are you lonesome?
Go, 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 go.
Come with you.